I'd like to call the school committee October 27th meeting to order. First up is going to be the Pledge of Allegiance from our Swallow Union Grade 4, our students Charlie and Artie. You want to come up and, oh, you're already up? And raise, Dan will, flag's right behind us.
Okay. Ready? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you for joining us. Would you guys like to tell us a little bit about yourselves? Whoever wants to go first.
I'm Charlie Han from Swallow Union Elementary, fourth grade. I don't have one favorite subject. Math and writing are equally important to me. In math, I like to be mentally challenged and figure out harder problems to help me learn. Writing allows me to use my imagination when creating a book. I can also create a book with fictional beings, making it seem as if they exist. Even though these two are my favorite, I like every subject and every teacher. One thing I like about Swallow Union is all the fun and cool activities that we do. Another thing is how kind all the teachers are, and because the school is small, you get to know everyone pretty well. Swallow Union's giant playground and play structures are definitely a favorite for many kids, but I have a different favorite, school. I like the building and learning. Plenty of people agree with me and plenty think otherwise. But in the end, I think the best part of Swallow Union is the building itself and the people inside it.
Very good.
My name is Adi. I am from Swallow Union School studying fourth grade. My favorite subject is reading because reading books is really interesting. I'm listing only one because it is my most favorite one, though I like almost all the subjects. My teachers explain them really well. I like to see what happens to all the characters in the story when I read. What I like so much about reading is that when the author describes what the character is doing in detail, it's almost like watching a movie in my mind. I also like reading words from a book because it sometimes challenges my mind. One thing that I've enjoyed being in Swallow Union is that the teachers are kind and smart. I also like the recess structure. At school, we play fun learning games, which are so cool. Thank you for the opportunity to share this with you all.
So if it's okay with you guys, I'd like the school committee to see if they have any questions for you, and then you can ask us a few questions if you'd like.
Okay.
Okay. Why don't we start on the far right here and work our way down?
good job, guys. You did really good. I actually remember Adi and Charlie from my tour at Swallow Union, I believe in Miss Wynn's class. So it's nice to see you guys again. And I'll save the questions for later, but good job.
Thanks. So I think you both said you like reading, right? Do you have a favorite book or story that you like?
My favorite is like, I don't have like a single favorite, like I have lots of favorites.
I don't have one favorite book. I have a favorite type of book. I like fictional books because I like the fact that it can be something that's not even real.
Great, thank you.
Sure.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you. Really great job, you guys. You both did amazing. I guess my question would be, what do you guys like to do outside of school?
Outside of school, I do a lot of writing. I will sometimes read books before writing to get ideas, but I mainly like writing fictional books.
When I'm out of school, usually sometimes I draw, sometimes I play with my brother. Or I just read.
I'm glad to hear a lot about reading. So sometimes we characterize books as being books that are like mirrors. Mirrors are books that we see ourselves in. There's someone that's like us or has an experience like us or has the same number of brothers and sisters or likes the same things that we do. And some books are like windows, and they allow us to look into somebody else's life. So would you say you prefer books that are windows or books that are mirrors?
Sometimes I prefer windows because it's not that interesting to read about somebody like you over and over again.
I would say my favorite's probably windows because I would want to learn about other people.
Great, thank you.
So I thought that answer to that last question was awesome, just awesome. I'm one of those people that like to try and make something better. Even as better, as good as things are, I'd like to always try and make things better. So I know you guys love Swallow Union, obviously. If you had one wish and you had a magic wand, what would you do to make Swallow Union that much better?
That's actually kind of a hard decision.
I don't really know. I would probably keep it the same that it is now because it's already really great.
Awesome. Thank you.
So are you going to be running for school committee? Because that was a great answer. Yeah.
Right?
No, so what I'd like to ask you both is if you could tell me what was your favorite part of today at school?
For me, I think it was math and reading, because our teacher read a book, and in math we learned some cool stuff.
Probably still math and writing. We were working on our books in school today, and yeah, we learned a lot of cool things in math.
I guess I do have a question. One came to me. I expect that the answer might be pizza. If the answer isn't pizza, what's your favorite school lunch?
I don't eat school lunch. I usually eat lunch my mom packs me.
Oh, okay.
Probably the pancakes.
Oh, nice.
Okay, do you have any questions for us?
Is school committee interesting?
Oh boy, is it.
Cool.
What kinds of things do you do on school committee?
We approve the budget, so that way we have enough money for all the staff and the teachers to work and teach you guys, and books and curriculum. We set policies in the schools, so that way they govern how the schools are run. We hire the superintendent so she can manage the district. What else do we do, guys?
Policy.
That's right. We set policies in which our schools follow, so that way everything runs on the straight and narrow.
Is school committee like super hard or not that hard?
It depends on, yeah, it depends on the year. We tend to work hard as we can for our kids in our district. And we will do that every time the opportunity comes for us.
Okay, thanks.
If I could add, it takes a certain special kind of person to want to be on the school committee. Maybe that's the best answer or a good answer.
That's it? You're letting us off the hook? All right, well, I appreciate you guys coming here. I know the whole school committee does. Thank you very much. Awesome.
Thank you. Thank you.
Up next on our agenda are questions and comments on the public. Sure, come on up.
Do we not have a mic?
Thank you.
You know, I think he took it.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate it. Yes.
All right. I have something that I just want to read. I'll keep it short, short as I can.
Sure.
This time of night, I start rambling. I'm tired. So, I thought you, the public, should be made aware as to what is happening in our district. A couple of weeks ago, I attended the second DEI committee meeting. I was surprised to only see four members of the public attend and two police officers. Especially in the wake of what happened at the school that Monday, with racist comments being found in the middle school bathrooms. To me, it showed that our community does not find this as important as most want it to be. Because if they did, they would have shown up and voiced their concerns in person versus on social media. Everyone is appalled on social media, yet nobody shows up for the meetings. And when they do, they walk out after giving their 2 cents and they don't stay to listen and understand why decisions were made that has an impact on our kids. When I did attend the meeting, it was not my intention to speak or ask questions. But when Ms. Chesson mentioned that our district has been in contact with a company called Panorama, I felt I needed to inform the committee and speak up. This company has been in the news the last month. It collects data via surveys on students, parents, teachers, etc. CRT is also mentioned in multiple articles related to this company. There is also a known connection between Facebook and this company, and we all know Facebook is in hot water right now, and in the news on how they collect information and use it. It has also been announced that the founder of Panorama is married to the daughter of the Attorney General of the U.S. The Attorney General is pushing for using this type of company with his own agendas, which has now been called a conflict of interest. I can only assume that the Novak Consulting Company has made the suggestion to our district because there's also a connection found between these two companies. So I ask you, our elected school committee members sitting here tonight and our district administrator, Shin, do we really want to use or be affiliated with a company that's getting this much bad publicity and also speaks about using CRT when our district has made it clear that we will not be going in that direction regarding education? And also, I would like to be on record, when I raised my hand at the DEI meeting, I waited very respectfully to get a chance to speak. I was ignored twice. Mr. Cronin, who is the school committee representative who leads the DEI committee, finally said to me that he would speak to me afterwards. So I waited, and he made sure to make me wait. I finally left and ran into one of the committee members, and he asked me if I spoke to Mr. Cronin. I said no, I could not wait any longer, that I would bring my question to the school committee members, and I continued to walk out the door. Mr. Cronin just walked in and heard the last part, to which he responded with, "Do you have something to say to me?" His tone and body language was meant to intimidate me. This is not the first or second time he has spoken to a parent in this manner, and this is how he continually addresses parents. And then he is not the appropriate person to be leading the DEI committee meetings. Again, for the record, I ask the public to please keep in mind, Mr. Cronin does not feel our district is good enough for any of his three children as he chose to send them to other districts. Yet here he is making decisions for our children and our families. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. So I think I've said, God knows how many times, the clapping, please. Everyone that comes up, and I'm assuming there'll be other raised hands at different times, please clap for everyone, clap for nobody. Keep it consistent, just for the reason I want other people to feel comfortable. And I think I've repeated this several different times at meetings. Any other comments? Seeing none, and I just want to make it clear, the agenda tonight, it doesn't have a boatload on it as far as like bullets, but there are long discussions that we're going to have, especially the budget guidance. So if I see hands, and if I have the opportunity, I will allow you to speak. But in other words, comment period right now. If anyone has anything to say, it's definitely open right now. Okay. Thank you. Yes. We're going to move on to our work with Dr. Parker, Kristen DeFrancisco.
Hi, everyone. I wanted to make sure you could hear me. Actually, I can take my... We don't have any students,
no,
right? Okay. So I can take that off. Good evening. I will be juggling a couple of things tonight. So the first thing, actually, before I begin my presentation, would it be okay if I introduced the director pre-K? Okay. I wanted to take the opportunity to introduce you to Amanda Densmore, who's sitting over here in this corner. She's going to stand up and give a wave. Amanda is the new director of ELA pre-K to 6. And I have a couple things that I wanted to say about her. She comes to us from lots of experiences with reading and writing. She's been a staff developer for the Teachers College, which is where Lucy Calkins hails from. And so that means she knows a lot about the units of study in reading and writing. I have lots of favorite things about Amanda, but the couple that I will tell you about tonight is that, and this actually will lead into my presentation, you know, something that I've noticed with about Amanda in even just these first few weeks of school is that she understands that it's not only important what we teach, but how we teach it. And so she's worked really hard to understand the narrative of how reading and writing is being taught in our classrooms, and she's really working hard to understand how we can enhance what's going on even more than we have some great instruction going on right now, but she's enhancing that even more. I appreciate her ability to really take that data and understand that making changes too quickly would not be in the best interest, so she's figuring out what that should look, feel, and sound like. The other couple of things that I will mention is that she understands that it's important for kids to feel safe and supported in their classrooms beyond reading and writing. So she understands and knows that ABCDE is important to our work. She collaborates with our entire team as she's planning reading and writing instruction. And that means a lot to me as the director of curriculum and instruction, and it's rare. So I appreciate that you're here. Welcome to Groton-Dunstable, and I look forward to continuing the great work we've already started. So thank you. On that note, I get to talk to you a little bit tonight about that how, that what, and then how we know. I want to remind everybody, we talked a little bit about this last year as well, but when we talk about curriculum, instruction, and assessment, it's threefold. We talk about the what we teach, and the what we teach is the Massachusetts State Frameworks. So while we don't have a lot of wiggle room in there, I mean, that's what we're teaching. That's our content. So you can see that content in our scope and sequences. But the how we teach is what we're really working hard to figure out what works best for kids and how we're doing that in a way that's in service of equitable outcomes. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that tonight when we talk about, which was introduced so skillfully by Dr. Chesson, that that notion of windows and mirrors. I couldn't have asked for a better segue from the students. I didn't know they were going to talk about reading, and it's actually a really great concrete way to talk about why it's so important that we think about the books that we're putting in front of our kiddos. And then the third part is how we know what we're teaching is working and what tweaks we might need to make. So those are the three parts of thinking about curriculum. So I wanted to talk a little bit about that before we start and dig in a little bit more to that windows and mirrors. And why we're calling this an ABCDE update is because this is a real tangible of how we're doing that. So we've talked a lot about theoretically ABCDE. We wanted to focus tonight on something that you could really see that was a tangible of that work. Sometimes this advances, sometimes it doesn't. Excellent. So the next thing that I wanted to share with you is that as we're looking through this lens for CIAA, we're thinking about ABCDE. One of the examples that I want to be giving you is not just about windows and mirrors, but I also want to talk a little bit about our relationship that we're building with Dr. Parker. It's far away, so there's a delay. Did we get it? Okay. So Dr. Parker is someone we have teamed up with to help us think about our literature choices. And those literature choices are important. As you just heard this evening, those students are pretty jazzed about reading, right? They want to pick up books and they want to be transported. I think one of them had said, if the author is a good author and can really describe, it's like you're watching a movie. So you can see that kids really do like to get lost in those books. And one of the ways we're being responsible about thinking about how to choose literature is working with Dr. Parker. So the next slide will give you just a little bit of information about her, and I can tell you what we've done with her so far. I will read to you only because I know people at home might not be able to see this as well, and I'd like them to be able to understand who we're talking about. Dr. Parker is an award-winning educator. She is a literacy consultant and a writer based in Boston. She holds steadfast belief in the power of literacy to normalize the high achievement of all students. She's currently the director of the Crimson Summer Academy at Harvard University and is completing a book with the Association for Curriculum and Supervision Development to document her successful literacy work based on her classroom and professional development experiences. So we can look forward to that in the spring of 2022. She is the recipient of the 2020 recipient of the National Council of Teachers of English Outstanding Elementary Educator Award. So she comes with lots of accolades, and what do those things mean? Well, what that means is when she's thinking about the books that she would put in front of students, she's really thinking about equity. And she's thinking about how we choose books that are really interesting to students, no matter what their narrative is, where they're coming from, how they learn, what cultures they might be bringing into the classroom with them. And so right now we're just really talking at the administrative level about how she can consult with us. As I said, Amanda is new to us and she's been talking with Dr. Parker. Allison Sansonito, who is our social emotional learning director, has been talking with Dr. Parker. So we're really just at the very beginning of how we might use her as a resource. And we're thinking about our libraries, not just our larger libraries, but our classroom libraries as well. How do we do? Okay. So when you look, as Dr. Chesson was describing earlier, when you look in a mirror, you see yourself. The image looking back at you resonates because it's you. So you're able to really relate to that person in the mirror. And when you look through a window, you're looking out at something else. So you're trying to see what that through that window is presenting to you and what you can maybe learn from what you see there. And in order for students, I think, to feel accepted and like they belong, they need to see themselves in the books that they read. In order for them to develop an understanding of the world around them, they need to see other stories and narratives that are not just theirs. In this way, we create that community that we were talking about in our ABCDE equation. We're often asked as educators how we can help grow the seeds of empathy. That is a question I'm asked all the time. How do you help students be empathetic? It's hard to do that. It's hard to help students to be empathetic, but I think one of the ways we can do that is through literature and books. You know, we can grow those seeds of empathy through understanding, and part of that is to know that not everyone's stories are the same. When each person looks in the mirror, they see something different. What one person sees in the mirror could be another person's window. Both are very important, and both should be celebrated. So how will we capture that in the classroom? And I also have a clip that I'm going to have to, your job when I walk to the back to switch the projector is to cross your fingers that when I get there, it's going to switch and you'll be able to hear it because we have a little bit of a interesting sound system back there. But what I'd like you to think about is that the background of the speaker that you're about to hear, his name is Akan Duggar. He is the speaker in this TED Talk, and at the time of the TED Talk, Akan was a junior at Mountain Valley High School. He's now a senior. He is the web managing editor-in-chief of Oracle, still in high school, a passionate film student at Freestyle Academy, and an avid volunteer with E3 Youth Philanthropy. He talks about growing up exposed to books written by a homogeneous set of authors, and the message that he talks about is how these books influenced the way he was learning to see the world and write about it. It did not include any mirrors, it only included windows. So you'll get to hear him talk about his experience. It's 10 minutes long, and I know that we want to make sure that we're respectful of time. So what I have done is given a little bit of a summary of the beginning so that you can understand the piece that I am going to show you. So these are the books that he was reading in India, and so were all of his friends. This India is where he is from. It was similar when he came to the United States, when he moved here to the United States. These were the books that were on his reading list in his classrooms, recommended by his family, his parents. And this will show you, these are the characters in those books. And when he's talking with the audience in this TED Talk, he says, you know, they notice they all look the same. So what he talks about is that these are his windows, and I will also introduce sliding doors to you in just a moment. These windows, and there were doors, but there were no mirrors for him when he was young. So we're going to pick up on the video where he starts to talk and share about what happened to him as a reader when he found some mirrors. And so this is going to help you understand why it's so important that we have both things. So I will move back to the back of the room just momentarily, and remember your job is to cross your fingers.
So while Kristen is moving to show you part of the video, I want to remind everyone, I don't know, you could possibly have forgotten because we say it all the time, but A stands for all students will be accepted, B stands for all students will be belong, C stands for all students will be part of a larger school community, D says we're going to give those district-wide supports that are necessary for all students to have equitable outcomes. And so this is a discussion on our work in terms of literacy, in terms of A, B, C, D is equal to E.
Educated properly. But I, on the other hand, wasn't reading books written by people like me, about people like me, or set where I was living. So there was this disparity between what I was reading and what I was actually living. But one day, while I was still in India, my grandmother handed me a book called Malgudi Days by R.K. Narayan. I flipped to the back cover and there was a picture of a brown guy on it. It was like this cognitive dissonance between what I thought authors were and what I was seeing. Now, it wasn't that extreme, obviously, but I knew there were Indian authors, but this was the first time I'd ever been exposed to one, and I devoured that book. It was the first time I was reading something meaningful to me, something that I could truly identify with. This book was my first mirror. I could identify with what the plots of the stories were. I could identify with the cultural references in the book, and I could identify with myriad colorful characters. And so I moved on, and I found a whole world of books that I could find mirrors in. More Indian series were the Shiva trilogy and the Ram Chandra series, which are basically Percy Jackson books with Indian gods. This awakening occurred around the time that I moved back to the US when I was around 11. So I found mirrors in books about the immigrant experience. Books like The Joy Luck Club, Americana, the spirit catches you when you fall down, and the namesake. There were some cultures I was unfamiliar with, and this is where I found some novels to become my windows and sliding doors. The autobiography of a Tibetan monk and A Long Way Gone gave me insight into the lives of a Tibetan monk imprisoned by the Chinese government in the 70s and a child soldier in Sierra Leone. I genuinely believe that reading these books, my mirrors and my sliding doors, allowed me to widen my perspective and understand other people's better, contributing largely to who I am today. I was fortunate enough to discover them, realizing that not only one type of person is an author, or that not only one type of person deserves to have their story told, a realization that I've come through my own writing. My mother is a teacher of the deaf and hard of hearing, and used to teach at a school called the Weingarten Children's Center, a school for children who are deaf and hard of hearing. I went to the school as a preschooler, even though I'm not deaf, so I was in what was called a reverse mainstream program, and it was here that I made my first friends. I'm still friends with Aria, who's currently a senior at Saratoga High. Aria is profoundly deaf, meaning she can't hear anything really without her cochlear implants. One day, Aria and I were talking about how little her classmates actually knew about her deafness and the obstacles that she faced because of it. I was fortunate enough to have the experience of being in a reverse mainstream program at the School for the Deaf, and I realized that I had the opportunity to share the knowledge I'd gained through this experience with others. I had the opportunity to create something that could be somebody's window or sliding door. So I wrote a story about Maya, a little girl who is deaf and has cochlear implants, from the perspective of Sid, a little boy who is hearing and very curious about Maya's cochlear implants. I was able to write from the perspective of Sid because I was in his position once. I was a hearing child who was very curious about his friend's cochlear implants. I was able to write the story because I was writing what I knew. I finished the book in January of last year. After it was published, I read it at some local schools with Aria. At the end, we conducted an activity and found that the book was some of the students' first exposures to people who were deaf or hard of hearing, and that they learned something completely new to it from it. In these readings, my book was able to be a window and a sliding door for other children, offering them a new perspective. But it was also able to be a mirror. While working on it, Aria told me how amazing it was for her to see a deaf Indian girl featured as the main character in a book, and how real the story felt to her. Another little deaf girl living in India, who was reading the book, excitedly pointed to Maya's cochlear implants in one of the illustrations to compare it to her own. Over the past year, I've continued to hear back from several other families whose children were able to identify with Maya. My experiences reading diverse literature, books that were mirrors, windows, and sliding doors, inspired me to share that same experience with others through writing. So if you've only been reading one kind of author, go out and seek new ones. Realize that not only one type of person can write books, and not only one type of person deserves to have their story told. Find your mirrors, your windows, and your sliding doors. Thank you.
You booked a cozy Virgo mountain cabin.
Which I'm assuming you did not do.
I think one of the most profound one of the most profound things in that video is when the student says, not only one type of person gets to have their story told, not only one type of person can be a writer. And when we watched this, this really resonated for us. Oh, what'd you do, leave your mic up there? Oh, your clicker.
Our clicker.
While we're waiting for Kristen to come back, I would entertain a motion to approve the meeting minutes from October 13th.
Second.
Any discussion on the meeting minutes? Seeing none, all those in favor?
I appreciate your efficiency. It's great. And as Laura said, I think one of the most meaningful things is that you hear about narratives is that everyone's story deserves to be told, and they're powerful. And students, as you heard, they attach themselves to other people's narratives. As a matter of fact, I found it very interesting that both of those students picked they would rather read window books where they get to learn about other people. The other thing that I wanted to talk a little bit tonight about is that how this came about as I was talking with some eighth grade teachers about the books that they're choosing and picking and putting in front of our students. And this is how this idea of windows and mirrors and sliding doors. The sliding door piece is you can slide the door open and invite people into your world. And I think that that's probably something we think about developmentally, how kids are ready to do that. But we're also making sure we're asking these questions about why we're choosing the narratives that we're choosing, and do they provide both mirrors and windows, and eventually for kids sliding doors. I attach this metaphor because I think it transcends age. You can talk about windows and mirrors with kids from kindergarten all the way through 12th grade. So it's a really nice concrete thing or metaphor for them to be thinking about. I also think that this transcends books. And so when we think about how we're going to use this in the district, we don't just need to think about the fact that this would work in literature. We can also be thinking about mirrors and windows across other subject areas, which is something we're just starting certainly to think about it in infancy, but it's something that kids will be able to get some background and some prior knowledge around in reading and in the books that they're exposed to, but then also we can grow this into other spaces in our culture and climate, in our schools and our buildings. I know that was a little long, but I appreciate you sitting and listening and hearing about why it's so important for students to have both mirrors and windows in our classrooms. And Amanda and I certainly will be working toward that end, as will classroom educators. Reading and writing is a very powerful way to use our words, which is another one of our initiatives in the district. So we're happy to be doing that work, and we can't wait to keep you updated on all the mirrors and the windows that we put into the classrooms for our students. So thank you.
School committee, any questions or comments?
I'll make a comment. So I just thought that it's a great concept you brought forward. I think it's one of those things that was out there in front of me. Once you explain it, it makes complete sense, and I'm very glad that we're bringing this to our district, and I never would have thought of that before, so I think it's great.
Okay. Moving on to the COVID-19 update, Superintendent.
Yeah, that's you. while Kristen runs back up the aisle again, I just want to also add is that part of our work around ABCDE is that we are working on our plans for being part of a week called Unite Against Hate, and that will be work that we'll be doing with our ADL partners, not only World of Difference, but Hate Does Not Belong Here. Hate Does Not Live Here, that's a program that is also done by the ADL across the state. So we'll be working on that. More of that will be available at the next school committee meeting. While she gets it queued up, tonight we're going to, as usual, talk about our updates for COVID in terms of our, I'm sending it to you right now in case for some reason it's not at the top of your pile. Vaccination rates for our students for grades 12 to 15 and 16 to 19, positive test cases in the last 14 days, and Kristen already did the update on ABCD is equal to E.
I'll give you a budget motion if you would entertain one.
I'm sorry,
say I mean not a budget, a warrant.
What? Oh, want to do the warrant? Sure, do the warrant.
So I would make a motion that we accept two payroll warrants totaling $2,085,323.13 four AP vendor warrants totaling $2,320,058.29 for a grand total of $3,361,555.29.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, a roll call vote. Rafi?
Yes.
Jeff?
Yes.
Lacey?
Yes.
Marlena, yes. Brian?
Yes.
Faye?
Yes.
So as we present every time we have school committee, these are our current vaccination levels for student and staff. Students, this was as of the October 21st MDPH report.
We've basically plateaued at our 12 to 15-year-olds in Groton, and the same thing for our 16 to 19-year-olds in Groton. There's been a slight increase on Groton vaccination rates overall. And in Dunstable, again, we plateaued in the 12 to 15-year-olds. There's a very slight change in the 16 to 19-year-olds, and there's a plateau in the 64 and 60, in the overall. Going on to the next slide, so we now have an ability to get a much more discrete number. I know that, so I'll show this slide, but the next slide I think is more telling because we have a discrete number. We're able to now identify which of the 12 to 15-year-olds and which of the 16 to 19-year-olds are physically at Groton High School, Groton-Dunstable High School, and so I think that that's more meaningful, but you will see when I put these two things together where we are in terms of vaccination rates. So go to the next slide. So we have an exact count of the number of students that are, of the exact count of the number of students that are vaccinated at the high school, that's 584. And there are 95 staff members, of which 99% are vaccinated. So when I combine the vaccination rates for the students and the staff, the overall vaccination rate right now for the high school is 88%. I want to remind everybody that the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education yesterday extended the mask mandate to January 15th. There have been about 8 schools in Massachusetts that have applied to relax mask mandates at the high school level. Our guidance that the school committee has set is for 90%. I'm not sure if we'll get to 90%, but we are at 88% right now. The other thing that I want to state, and we'll get into a minute about the individual cases, is that the high school has been doing pool testing since the beginning of the school year. We have not had any positive pools at the high school. We have had a very small number, I think it's 3, students that have tested positive at the high school. All those students have been unvaccinated, and all those students have reported to us that they have contracted COVID outside of the school. So we're going to skip the progress towards 90% because I just talked about that. The 14-day average, as you can see, we've seen some improvement in Groton and in Dunstable over the last 14 days. When I go to the positivity rates, for the two towns, you can see that Groton's positivity rate has dropped. Again, positivity rate is what percentage of the tests were positive. At this time, very few people are going to get tested if they don't believe that they might be positive. And then, so you're going to get a higher positivity rate than if you're just testing the entire population. And you'll see Dunstable's positivity rate and the state's positivity rate. So across the board, we're seeing some improvement. If we go on to the slide that talks about cases as of 10/27/21, as we've stated before, we report to the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. So the reason we're using numbers that last week we had one positive case. It was a staff member at Florence Roach. This week we have another positive case at Florence Roach, the staff member. And we have 3 positive cases for students, 1 at the Swallow, 1 at middle school, and 1 at high school. Again, all of those students reported to us that they had family members that had tested positive prior to their testing positive. And if we look at our cumulative rates, there they are to the right of that. So that is where we stand with the COVID updates. I will say that we have been working with several of the local medical providers, and with the assumption that next week the FDA will approve vaccination rates for 5 through 11, we will be providing, certainly with at parent discretion, vaccination clinics for those students. But I will state again that we have a very, very high percentage rate of vaccination at the high school and an extraordinarily low positivity rate and exposure rate to COVID. We also have a fairly high vaccination rate in grades 7 and 8, and we have also had an extraordinarily low number of cases at grades 7 and 8. The vast majority of our cases, 99.9%, have been at the elementary school level and the middle school grades 5 and 6 level, where vaccinations are not available. So we just encourage families to think about what is right for their family. But we will be offering those to try to give you some convenience, and more information will be available next week. Is there any other questions about COVID before we go on?
I had one point I wanted to ask you to clarify. So I believe the state, when they set their 80% minimum at any school for unmasking or submitting a proposal for unmasking, that's students and staff.
Yes, school community.
And I went back and reviewed our Groton-Dunstable policy on masks, and I believe when we wrote it, we said 90% was students, not students and staff. Oh. And that changes the numbers a little bit. I was just curious, I don't know if you know off the top of your head, or if we'd have to look that up.
What students are like? 80%.
What our policy was, if it's in line with the states or if it's the way I just stated
it. No,
it's
different.
Where it's kind of moot until January 15th.
Right.
We can't make any changes till January 15th. Is that not correct?
That's correct.
Slide said.
We can't make any changes.
All right. So it's moot. If the committee so wants to revisit policy around about January 15th, let's do that. And we can also see where our positivity rate is, where our vaccination rate is, and go from there. I said, but for tonight.
I guess maybe I'm confused then, because I thought the state's policy in its entirety was going to expire in a week or two. So if they didn't extend it, then there would be no requirement for masks anywhere. So what's extended until January 15th is the required to follow their policy, unless you can apply for the exception like the whatever 7 or 8 schools did.
I'm going to be sending out from the desktop that I got from the commissioner's office, and that will clarify that. So, because we got a 5-minute conference call about this before it was announced yesterday, and frankly, I haven't had time to really look at it because I knew that we weren't going to get close to what the school committee policy
was. Right, yeah, that's fine.
The other thing I should say, though, is that the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education is working with the Massachusetts Department of Public Health to see if there are other metrics. So, for example, at the high school, we have a positivity rate that's, you know, like 3 people. At grade 7 and 8, we haven't had any cases since, I'm knocking on wood if I could find it, since the beginning of the school year. So they're looking at other metrics as well as the positivity rate in the community. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're going to go on to the next topic, which is to talk a little bit about the beginnings, very beginnings discussion about transitioning of the Groton students from Swallow Union to Florence Roach. We talked a little bit about this last week. We're going to talk a little bit about this week. I think there are many issues that we will need to talk to about a lot. So you can see for FY22 and FY21 what the current enrollment is at each grade from each town, what it was last year and what it is this year. Next slide. The currently enrolled Groton students at Swallow Union, so there's current first graders that would be in fourth grade when the building opened up in the fall of 24-25. They would be going into fourth grade. And the current kindergartners would be third graders in the fall of 24-25. The projected enrollment of Groton students in the new school that are currently in Swallow would be those 25 students that are in fourth grade, those 25 students that are in, 24 students that are in third grade, and then we're projecting, since those students are not enrolled at this time, 25 students at grades 2 and 1 in kindergarten. So about 124 students, leaving 184 or 37 students in each grade that are from Dunstable at the school.
The numbers from 21 to 22, is there any differential in regards to homeschooling and COVID that may have impacted those numbers? Okay.
We definitely had some students that returned from homeschooling. We do see enrollment increase this year at Swallow Union,
and about half of that is students from Groton that are attending Swallow Union, and half of that are students from Dunstable that are attend. So I just want to talk a little bit about the timeline. Right now, we're being told that in our conversations with the construction company, and now we have to remember that not one shovel has gone into the ground here. So this has got lots of room for changes in terms of that. But they're projecting that the new building would be available for occupancy in the spring of 24. If that's the case, the senior staff and the principal and the assistant principal of the building and I have had discussions that said that at that point, we would not move Swallow students that were from Groton in the middle of the school year. We would not recommend that to the committee. But we would move students in that are currently in Florence Roach to the new Florence Roach. So all of those Groton students would move into the new building. I have moved buildings in the middle of the school year. Kids have way less trouble than teachers with it. Many times it's the move happens over a weekend. We're projecting April vacation. The beginning of the step down in... there's a slide that's missing, sorry. I'm gonna, in 1 second, I'm gonna talk about the rooms that are left and what they're slated to be used for. So the beginning of the step down for capital expenses, because our capital expenses on each building are done by a 5-year enrollment rolling average, would begin in FY20. So in the beginning of FY20, the enrollment that would be considered for the 5-year rolling average for FY20 would be zero. So you would add the enrollment for FY24, for FY23, 22, so on and so forth, 5 years back. And then you would divide by 5, and that would be the enrollment that's used for capital expenses. The final step down year would be FY29. So up until FY29, some portion of the capital expenses for Swallow Union would be borne by Groton. And the majority of it would be borne by Dunstable, and then it would get more Dunstable and less Groton every single year from 25 to 29. There will be 5 classrooms, and I apologize, this slide was missing, I must have not saved it. There will be 5 classrooms that will be empty when those students are moved, and every single one of those classrooms has already been spoken for in about a minute and a half this afternoon as we had our meeting with senior staff. There is no conference room in that building whatsoever, so if we have to have a team meeting with a large number of parents and speech-language pathology, OT, PT, SLP, it has to happen in a classroom that becomes problematic during the school day. So they do need a conference room. There is no classroom right now for students that are ELL, and we see those numbers increasing slowly, but increasing across the district. We have 2 special education or 3 special education programs that are currently sharing a room, and they would be able to have their own appropriate facilities. The team chair does not have, basically has a closet. The special education team chair is basically in a closet, and they would have a room. So every single one, the day those students walk out of the building, every single one of those rooms would be repurposed. So the fear that there would be 5 empty rooms and no one would be using them. I can assure you there were more reasons to have a room than there were rooms available. So we feel very comfortable that all the space would be utilized. Done.
Does any of the school committee members have any questions for Laura? Jeff?
So the projections that you had in here, those are just estimates. They're not based on like the surveys that we did for Florence Roach in terms of projections or
From NESDEC. Yeah. The MSBA projections for enrollment are notoriously low. So I feel like what we have historically, and because remember, it's a close-in historical in the sense that we already know who the fourth graders will be. We already know who the third graders will be. So it's K-1 and 2. I feel like we're getting a much better estimate by using the historical numbers that we have. MSBA takes in births, deaths, average move-in, average move-out, but I have opened three schools that have been full or overcrowded the day that they have been opened based on MSBA numbers, so I'm not real comfortable using those. Kristen, too.
Do you have another? No? You guys good? Okay. You're not looking for any sort of vote or anything else?
Just questions.
I should remind, well, thank you, Jeff, for reminding the policies that exist. JC and JCA, I believe they are. They're on our website under the school committee page. They do govern school registration for different kids in the district. So that's something that was updated. I think the most recent one was June of 2021, if I'm not mistaken. And obviously Florence Roach was in the works at that time when we approved that policy. But again, Laura, if you believe that policy needs to revisit it, then there's the chair. We can go from there. Okay, next up is the budget guidance for FY23. I'm gonna let Brian lead the discussion on this because we did have it at the Budget and Finance Subcommittee meeting prior to this with a recommendation made.
Give me 1 second to load that up.
I updated it. It's in the packet.
So yeah. Okay. So on this particular item, we discussed this at Budget and Finance. A motion was made and approved to recommend the guidance as you see it in the packet to the full school committee. I don't know if anyone has any particular questions or items they'd like to review.
So the draft for the budget guidance is very similar to last year. In fact, it's very similar to last year because this year we almost have a Groundhog's Day kind of year in regards to the budget. The main difference, and I'm pulling it up now, I'm sorry, I have to make it bigger because my eyes are just old now. The biggest difference that I want to point out, which is no longer in blue, is to explore adjusting the five-year budget projections to include incremental amounts of scheduled uses of IAN excessive and deficiency funds to help decrease assessments to member towns over the next 5 years. That was my add-on to bring to discussion here. We know just from the past 3 years at least, to my memory, Dunstable absolutely was looking at overrides. Groton came close. Groton passed a debt exclusion for a lot of money that is going to increase people's taxes significantly. So what in my mind, my thought process here is E&D is not our money, it's taxpayers' money. So I do believe that we should never let it get depleted, but I also do believe that we should give our taxpayers the opportunity to utilize it to maintain our services instead of raising taxes. When we get to a point that we can no longer do something like that and still have a security level, then you go back to the towns and say, all right, we need to raise taxes if you want to maintain a quality school district or if you want to maintain quality municipal services, quite frankly. So we used, over the last 4 years, we used $200,000 one year, we used $400,000 another year, we authorized $800,000 the year prior to last year, and last year we maintained a flat level at 8. So I don't know what the magic number is because that's not my job, that's Sherry's job, and that's Laura's job. But my thought process is not to use 8 again, but maybe to use a little bit lower than 8 this year, and in the projections build in the use of it, so that way if Dunstable does need an override, it doesn't have to be as large. It can be more manageable. And if Groton happens to end up needing an override right now, the projection in Groton, and it's very early in the budget, from the Groton Select Board meeting that I had viewed and Brian attended in my absence, which I appreciate, Brian, they are having a deficit of somewhere between $120,000 and $320,000. Assuming they're meeting around about our five-year projection that we're using. So they're really not all that far off in Groton. However, my concern, particularly at this moment, is Dunstable. And obviously, any break that we can kind of give back to taxpayers in either town, I think, really needs to be revisited. So that's throwing that out there. I know also, before someone tells me it goes against our policy, it goes against our policy, our financial policy of maintaining 3%, because I believe right now we're at, I'm going to ask you, Sherry, what the percentages of expected E&D certification. I know it's not certified yet.
It's looking about 4%.
Okay, so we're 1% above our level that we usually try and maintain right now. And a lot of that, we did go through this a couple meetings ago to remind people. A lot of that is we couldn't fill the positions that we needed. There were some expenses that actually didn't come in. We also had some reimbursement from COVID money. So that did participate in that E&D, which is in line with actually what our towns certify in free cash in their towns as well. So anyway, I'll explaining where my thought process is, opening it up to whoever wants to participate in the conversation. I'm going to go, Brian.
Yeah, so I shared a few thoughts at BNF, and I'll echo some of those here. I don't have a problem with using some of this. I mean, certainly, you know, we build a contingency line into the budget. We, on some years, we may use that contingency. Other years, we not. There are other factors that contribute to how much money gets rolled into E&D on any given year. I don't think that we should be going, you know, well above our guidance, nor do I feel we should be going significantly below it. So I don't have a problem with going, you know, to a certain level below 3%, whether that's 2% or, you know, 1.8. But certainly, I don't want to see us wipe that out to nothing. You know, COVID happened. No one foresaw that. I don't expect that we're going to have, you know, the 100-year flood equivalent, you know, which is what COVID was to us. Again, all in 1 year, but we never know. And had we not had the money that we had for the pandemic, it would have been much more catastrophic to us. So I would definitely be an advocate for not using it all or not making a huge dent in it.
I support the idea of number six. I think that the complexity is in understanding the assessment of Dunstable. And I feel like it's such a wild card every year that I don't know how we work around that. And there's a lot of work that has to be done with Dunstable to program that line item. Am I not talking into the mic?
Oh, sorry. All right, now I'm talking into the mic.
Yes.
What'd
you say?
did we not hear? I'll say it again. I think that there's a lot of variability to the assessment in Dunstable that has driven a lot of our conversations around excess and deficiency, and that we really need to, in order to do five-year projections around that use, we have to understand where Dunstable's at. And so I feel like we're chasing our tail a little bit on this because COVID aside, this has been an ongoing issue that we've had to deal with, and I don't feel like it is resolved, and it's going to spin us around for another 3 years, and I don't know how to resolve that. So although I appreciate the line item, I just don't know how we would possibly schedule around E&D without that very large variable being nailed down.
Right. So my thought process in regards to it, first of all, we're going to have meetings with the municipal boards, right? Right now, from just last year, looking at last year in review and the year before that, if we did not utilize E&D, there would have been either an override or that passed, or a failed override that would have created either one of two things: cuts to the schools, cuts to municipal, or a super town meeting. Right? There's only so many paths forward. So looking at that past as a roadmap, which is eventually the rubber hits the road eventually. So if the rubber hits the road, it's not a matter of, in my mind, it's not a matter of does Dunstable, what is the number that we use to make it workable for Dunstable? I don't believe it's going to be workable for Dunstable. I think my logic is to make it more palatable to Dunstable. That's, yes. I think we have to do what we can do without jeopardizing the services of our students, and then we'll go from there.
Right, and I guess that's my point. And I'm glad that you clarified the palatable part, because I feel like too often we have actually managed E&D around not palatable, but what needed to be done to make it work at the time. And you opened the statement with, you know, we need to make sure that that E&D is used to go back into the district, not necessarily to reduce the assessments of the neighboring town. Mm-hmm. So there's a big conversation that has to happen around that. And I hope we can have a conscientious decision about what we're going to be doing moving forward on both sides of this. Because I know the last time we left it, and of course that was, you know, before COVID, was that Dunstable would be discussing a tax increase.
I mean, I think, as Marlena pointed out, we are planning on sitting down with Select Board and Dunstable. I think until we do that, you know, we can't really make any plans. But I think that, in general, I agree with the idea of number six. I think that we need to be clear as a board in terms of how much of that we're willing to utilize and do, you know, what we need to do on our end. And then we can present it to the towns as this is what we have and see where that lands us.
So just in the interest of time and not being circular here, unfortunately, October 20th, that was the meeting. 2 hours before we were supposed to meet, the chair of the advisory board canceled it. So we were this close to getting there. They haven't set a new one, but at that meeting was supposed to be literally all of it. Lacey, I, myself, Laura, Sherry, maybe Marlena, I don't know, you know, to get it rolling. Because like you said, this has been going on for 3 years, but Lacey and I have been, you know, new to the party. So we are catching up, and unfortunately we were gonna do it last week, but they canceled it for some reason. So once the new meeting happens, we'll let you know.
Jeff?
Specifically on this E&D question?
Yeah, well, anything at all.
Okay. well, as far as the E&D, I think that's should be part of the normal budgeting process, is looking at that. I think what's being asked here is to explore that, and I'm okay with that. The only, call out that I might have here is, and I understand it's not necessarily a big budget driver, but calling out the strategic plan and the district goals as something that we're trying to support here, not just sort of student services, but also the way it reads, it kind of seems like we're just gonna keep everything in the district as it is. And, you know, the budget should also support the growth and goals that we're looking to do in the district as well. And as I said, that may not move the needle in terms of the budget that much, but I think it's good to include it.
Is there, that would be what, number one, right?
Yeah.
Adjusting it. Is some wordsmithing you want to offer to, because I agree with you.
Even if it's, you know, support student services and district goals or,
okay.
Yeah.
Is anyone opposed to that update? No? It's a good catch, Jeff. Any other suggestions or concerns in regards to the budget guidance? And Jeff, you had it right. It's explore, meaning
yep.
I have no idea what's even possible. That's not my job. That's Sherry's and Laura's job.
This is strictly clerical, but the draft date at the top is last year, so just updating
yes.
that.
Oh, sorry. Any other? I'll ask the committee, do they want me to bring this back in November, or are you comfortable with the guidance?
I was going to ask, do you need a second read or whatever?
Technically does not need a second read because I wrote down discussion vote. I also was looking at, did we didn't do the budget calendar first, right?
We didn't.
No. Okay. The budget calendar has tentative dates in there in regards to in which the budget guidance would be approved. And I believe that might have been. Did Sherry put it down for tentative of the 27th?
I'll have to check. Hold on. And that was, in case anyone wanted to peruse that, I don't know if Sherry or someone else could add it to our meeting packet. It's in the BNF packet, but it's not in the full school committee packet.
Right. So we can't approve the budget budget calendar because it's not on the school committee agenda.
Oh, sorry. I missed that.
I'm comfortable voting or approving the budget guidance.
I would entertain a motion if someone would feel so compelled.
I would make a motion to approve the school committee fiscal year 23 budget guidance draft 10/27/21, making it not a draft.
Second.
Discussion. Okay, seeing none. All those in favor? Okay. Yeah, budget calendar will come back first meeting in November, whenever that is.
Is it just
Joanne, we don't have a meeting? November?
November 10.
November 10.
Okay. So liaison subcommittee meetings. Want to start that? All right, Lacey.
Okay, so I don't have a liaison report at this time, but I wanted to just take a minute to recognize Swallow Union. They were just ranked 16th elementary school in the state by U.S. News, which is an incredibly impressive accomplishment, though not a surprising one. I think all of us Swallow parents know how hard all of the faculty and staff work every day, so I just wanted to congratulate them on that and to Dr. Chesson as well. Thank you.
Very good.
Also on Swallow Union, I was emailed by a member of the community to alert us to the MCAS scores, I believe, from, it must have been last year. Our Swallow Union students and Florence Roach students apparently scored very well in top percentile, so we should be very proud of them too. So congratulations to them. And a member of their staff is here with us tonight, so it's a testament to them as well. In terms of the legislature, this is a bit of a lengthy one. Everyone's aware of what redistricting is. It happens every 10 years. Our House district at the State House and the Senate district, unfortunately, have changed. Our current House district, which is represented by State Representative Sheila Harrington, is Dunstable, Groton, Pepperell, Townsend, Ashby, and a piece of air, which is Fort Devens. The new district, Dunstable, Townsend, Pepperell, Ashby, half of Groton, and half of Lunenburg. Groton is now split between two representatives. The current representative over there that will take the rest of Groton is Representative Danilo Sena, I believe. So he has half of Groton as well. These changes will take effect after the November 2022 elections. So January 2023, the new maps will be out. For the Senate district, the current and old district is Dunstable, Groton, Pepperell, Tingsboro, Westford, and Lowell. The new district, Dunstable, Pepperell, Lowell, Tingsboro, and Dracut. We took out Westford and Groton. Groton will now join, I believe, Senator Jamie Eldridge's district next door, and our senator is Senator Edward Kennedy. And again, even the senators and representatives might change after the elections. As you can see, anything we do in terms of graduation or just a report is now two representatives and two senators. Any questions? You can let any of their offices know, or myself, and I will try and invite the other two that haven't been in here at all, so we can all meet them. That's it for now. Thanks.
Jeff.
Has that been approved? Because I know it was proposed districts, but...
I believe the House has voted and passed it. I'm pretty sure the Senate has voted. If not, it's in the Senate now.
Any other liaison reports from down here? No. Yes. Representative from CPAC.
Hi, good evening. We have a meeting tomorrow night at 7 p.m. and we'd like to invite everybody. The information is on the district's website and it is via Zoom. And then I'd also like to announce that we are starting a middle school basketball clinic on Tuesday, November 2nd, and it's going to run 4 sessions and it's open to all levels. And all that information was posted as well today on the district, on the middle school website. That's all. Thank you.
Faye, Brian, do you guys have anything? No.
Just one quick, just last. Yes. As I stated before, myself, Lacey, superintendent, and Sherry were all supposed to meet with the entire advisory board of Dunstable, which is basically their finance committee, the chair 2 hours beforehand canceled the meeting. We have not heard when there's a rescheduled date. We're pushing for an immediate one because Lacey would agree we're all in the same boat. We want the needle moved too. So we want to get some answers and some work done here. So once we know when it happens, we'll make everyone aware and hopefully get it taken care of. Thank you.
Yep, Lacey's going to touch base with them just to finalize what date. I'm sure it's on their horizon.
I figured, yeah, rather than waiting for them to let us know, we'll just reach out to them and figure out what the plan is going to be.
Yep, sounds good. I'm under liaison. I want to just remind everyone that here at the Performance Arts Center, Tuesday, November 9th at 7 p.m., Etched in Glass, The Legacy of Steve Ross, the film is being projected here, ages 13 and up. It's free to the public, and it is multi-co-sponsored between Groton Police Department, Groton Select Board, Groton-Dunstable School Committee, Dunstable Select Board, and the Dunstable Police Department. So if you want to attend that, again, November 9th, 7 p.m., I'll include that brochure in the Groton-Dunstable Regional School Committee's newsletter. It'll also go out in what's happening this week, I believe, and hopefully be able to get the newsletter out this week as well, if I can get it written, edited, and all that. So that is that. Also under new business, I'm not sure how the subcommittees feel about it or the rest of the school committee feel about it. But we wanted to find out if subcommittee meetings wanted to start at 6 p.m. and school committee meeting 6:30? No. No. If the school subcommittee meetings want to continue to start at 6, if they feel that the agenda is not as lengthy. I know that policy may be different because policy sometimes can be very lengthy. There's a lot of discussions in regards to that, but a lot of what we're finding for budget and finance is we're here at 6, we're done by 6:30, and now we're hanging around for 30 more minutes. So we were looking at possibly trying to coordinate a little bit better for more efficiency, subcommittees starting at 6, school committee starting at 6:30, if the subcommittee agendas allow. But I didn't know if the school committee members were available as early as 6:30 in the first place. I guess that would be my big question.
I'm usually available at 6:30.
I am as well.
I'd like to hear from all of you.
Yes, usually 6:30 works.
Yeah, it's fine.
We use the full hour at CIAA.
Well, we have CIA only, not every week, right?
No,
so,
once a month.
So how about this? Any subcommittee chair that needs more time, coordinate with me, and I can adjust the schedule time for the school committee, okay? But at this point, moving forward, as long as we have a consensus. Yes, Jeff?
Are we trying to start the school committee meetings earlier because, like...
Yes.
I'm
trying to start the school committees earlier for a couple of things. First of all, it allows us more time on a larger scale for discussions, which seem to be lengthier than our subcommittee meetings. And if our subcommittee meetings need that time, then just tell me and I'll reschedule the school committee to be 30 minutes later. Because otherwise we're sitting here twiddling our thumbs in between meetings.
So subcommittee or not, school committee meeting 6:30.
School committee meeting, 6:30. I only control those. The subcommittees are all independent.
So we, all our CIAA meetings are scheduled. Obviously, they're on the calendar. On those meetings, I would ask that the school committee start at 7.
Done. Can you email me to remind me? Because I'm old. Thank you.
Of course.
All right. Let me check the clock. What's that? I know. I checked the clock. It's 8:20. Before we leave, does anyone have anything to ask, say, comment, where there is time? I call the meeting adjourned.